let's put the values 1 micro, 10 micro, 20 milli and 5. Okay, so hysteresis is 5, 10 milli. Let's put 5 milli. I need to check whether it's hysteresis is a peak to peak here or half, so that we can look at the output. So this is your output. So looks like it's going peak to peak 5 milli. So this should be 10 in that case. Okay. By the way, I think we did our calculation at 0.5, so output should be 0.9. Okay. So let's see if the peaks are aligned or not. So probe. Current. So peaks are not aligned. You can see here, you still see some roll off here, non-linearity. One thing you can see here, when your output is changing. So, your comparator is forcing duty cycle 1 all the way until your output is, or the inductor current goes to load current and then it settles back. So, that is the advantage actually. So, your output will be limited by, you, if you remember, we to slope of the inductor actually. You do not have any bandwidth limitation here. That is why you get a transient response. Good. So now in order to meet, let us check the frequency. So it is coming 1.7 micro, but we designed for 1 micro. Because output is now not bounded, so that is why your frequency is increased, because now you have a phase shift, so that will introduce delay. So now if I want to meet that condition, how much RESR I require, or let us say increase the cap, because I want to limit the ripple to 10 millivolts, so how much you require? 2.5 times more. So let us make it 25 microfarad. So one thing you can see now, you do not have any ringing here. I mean, it goes, it dips and settles back very quickly. In there you are seeing some ringing because of that phase lag. Now you do not see any curve there, which was at the peak, around the peak. So your output is well bounded within your hysteresis window. So we kept plus minus 5 millivolts. So you can see 905 and 895. probe current in device. Now you can see here, so the peaks are, so the valley is coming at valley and peak is coming at peak. Let us look at frequency. So, it may not be exactly 1 micro because we did not, I mean we assume that the ripple due to capacitor is 0, but it is not actually 0. So, if you take that effect also, then you can recalculate your switching frequency, but let us see, it should be pretty close. Let us see how much off we are. It is 1.16. So, not way off, like it was coming 1.6 earlier. Now, if you keep increasing the capacitor, then you will get closer to 1 megahertz. But if you change the RESR, let us say I change the, make this RESR 40 milli, what should be the frequency? So, it will get double, almost double. So, let us see if that happens. So, now you can see output looks much cleaner. Now, it is almost linear because the non-linearity is gone. The basically the component which is coming from the capacitor is not there at all. So, it should be 500 nano. Where is the other cursor? Why it is coming 600 nano? 600 nano is how much? 1.16. Okay, wait. Let us measure here. I think duty cycle is changed there because we have applied the load. So, we need to measure here. It is coming 579. How much is this? 579? No, no, not 1.14, 1.75. Anyway, I will check and see. Maybe a delay in the comparator is causing that. So, it is less than what? Because so, there are several things which we did not take into account, the delays which are coming due to this power FET and then your comparator, everything. So, it will further reduce your frequency. Okay, so, this was the 20 milli is the bare minimum for 10 micro. 20 milli we calculated, no, sorry. 20 milli for 25 micro. 20 milli was for that switching frequency, but we were not meeting that RC product greater than TSW by 2. So, we had to make it 25 micro. So, now you can see, I mean you already saw, so, but the problem I cannot arbitrarily keep increasing the RESR, it will hamper my, I mean even let us say I can get back the switching frequency by reducing this hysteresis window. But the problem is when you apply a transient, instantaneous IR drop will happen here. So, let us say I am applying 1 amp. So, if I make it 50 milliamp, so 50 millivolt drop right away will be seen by this, and then on top of that from the capacitor discharge you will see. So, your transient may degrade. So, that is why we cannot just keep increasing that. So, I am applying 1 amp, so you can see, but still this, if you look at a transient response, this looks much better compared to your any other control like voltage mode, because we are not limited by bandwidth. So, in terms of transient, this is very good. The only problem is variable frequency. What is the other problem? So, variable frequency is one. What about the noise? So, if you look at this comparator is limiting the output between plus minus delta VH by 2, and if we define peak to peak ripple 10 millivolt, then we have only room of 5 millivolt on the higher side and 5 millivolt lower side. Now let us say my output is a load is switching. When the load is switching, it will create noise in the output, random noise, okay. So at any time your comparator might trip actually if it tries to cross that window. So you might see random output coming at the comparator. So it won't be like a looking like a clean PWM at one frequency, but your frequency may go all the way around and it will look very bad actually. So your spectrum will not be at one frequency, but it may spread and interfere with your system. So noise is another problem, and there are some techniques which how we get rid. So that is why it is not very good. So one way is like I should increase the hysteresis window, okay. So if I increase the hysteresis window, then which means I will get larger ripple output. So there is a trade off between your ripple and your noise, and also if I increase the ripple then hysteresis window, then my transient response also will go bad, because now I have to wait 50 millivolt. So let us say I make it 10 times more ripple, so which means you are looking at a 950 millivolt and lower side is 850 millivolt. So unless my output goes below 850 millivolt, comparator will not respond. So you cannot achieve better than 50 millivolt undershoot here. And then after that you have all the delays and everything, so it may go very bad. So there is a trade-off here, and now we will see how we, so which means we have to have some other way of decoupling the ESR and hysteresis window, which means decoupling the output ripple and hysteresis of the comparator. So we will take the feedback from somewhere else instead of taking from the output, okay. So next class we'll talk about that. So this is only suitable for large ESR, you can say. For a small ESR, it means, so let's say I make RESR 1 millivolt. It's very almost impossible to design this, it will always be unstable. But most of the case we look for very high quality cap. So then in that case it will not work with that. So now we'll see a technique where you can still design a hysteretic converter and make the RESR 0. So it will be completely independent of RESR, and also the switching frequency will not depend on your L and RESR or any power path actually this. So it will be only function of your, so basically now it will be in your fully control the switching frequency. That is what in my thesis, after that if you read that chapter whole talks about that actually, fixed frequency hysteretic converter. Now if your frequency is in your control, then you can make it fixed frequency also. Okay. So I know I cannot change RESR, the only thing I can change is the hysteretic window, but hysteretic window will get reflected into ripple also, and I cannot make it very low. I cannot make 1 millivolt ripple, it will become much more sensitive to noise, and also you cannot control with such a high resolution that hysteresis. So we will see what are the different ways to control the frequency, and you can exactly lock at frequency you want actually. At one, I can always operate at 1 megahertz irrespective of where V in and V out are, okay.